Okay, we start with introduction and rejoinder of what we did and what is relevant for this lecture. We go on with mixed models and then a little bit on longitudinal data. So we discussed mean and standard deviation and linear regression in the second and the third lecture. And actually what we always want to do is we want to know the truth. We have a large population and there is a true model, but we cannot observe the truth. We cannot measure everyone, so we sample, and in this sample we compute the mean and the standard deviation. So we have sample mean and sample standard deviation, and this sample mean is then a guess of the true mean in the population. And to know how certain we are about the sample mean, so how far can this sample mean be from the true mean, we use the standard deviation. Oh, I see that I have a parenthesis too much here. So we use the standard deviation of y divided by the square root of the total number in my sample. And that is the standard error of my mean, and 2 times the mean plus 2 times the standard error, and the mean min 2 times of the standard error. That is my confidence interval, and that is the range of possible values for the true mean based on my data set. But suppose now we have not random independent individuals, but we just put, for example, some of our individuals multiple times in our data set, so they are actually the same. If you then compute your sigma square, what would you think that would happen? So you have your data set, you sample n persons, but you make added some records and copy-paste some of your individuals. So you have actually correlated data. These records are the same, so they are highly correlated. What would happen with the sigma square if you estimate the sigma square based on this data set, ignoring the fact that you have cluster data, that you have some of those persons multiple times in your data set? What do you think what would happen with sigma square? Okay, will it be the same? Stay the same? Increased? Decreased. I think everyone agrees. And why?
Some
samples are the same and you don't take that into account, so you the variation is decreased, but actually you should have a larger value than you estimate. And since everything in the models is based on the standard deviation of y, everything is not well estimated. Yeah, so if we have correlation in the data, we should do something. In this case, because this was sampling, just putting records, duplicating of records, we just ignore them, of course, they are not informative. But if there is just correlation, not correlation of one, we have to do something, and we don't want to drop them. We want to use all the information. Okay, then we discussed the first lecture about random variables, probabilities, correlation. I think that was the third one. So suppose we have genotypes at a locus with two alleles, so you can be AA, AB, or BB. And we define a random variable X. A random variable X is a variable which is quantitative variables with numbers, and if it's discrete, you can count them. And we define it in this case as the number of A alleles a person has. So X is 2 if the person has 2 A alleles, X is 1 if the person is heterozygous, and X is 0 if the person has genotype BB. Now, we discussed that if you have such a random variable, you can compute the expectation and the variance of this random variable, and I gave you here the formulas. The expectation of this variable will be 2 times P, and the variance will be 2 times P times 1 minus P. But now let's consider that we have 2 siblings, and so we have the X value of sibling 1 and X value of sibling 2. Since these siblings have the same parents, these X's values will be correlated. They will not be independent. You agree with me? So we talked in the, we discussed in the third lecture, correlation or covariance of two different outcomes, like age and glycans, or glycan 1 and glycan 2. Here we're going to discuss covariance of the same variable, namely the genotype, but within a cluster of siblings, a cluster of families, etc. So these genotypes, these X values, are not independent. If we know one of the values for one of the SIBs, then we know also a little bit more about the genotype of the other SIB. So I put the formulas for in the first two lines again. So the genotypes of these two siblings are not independent. And we use then, so the problem is we need an other index, because we have now a person and a family. So let typically the first one is an I, that is for the larger unit, in this case a sibling pair, which can also be family or a class or whatever. Therefore we use the index I, and then J is the sibling J. So XIJ is the genotype of sibling J from family I. So if we then want to compute the covariance of X of sibling 1 of pair I and sibling 2 of pair Y, we can do the formula work, and I did it for you, is P times 1 minus P. But we remember that the covariance can be everything, can go from 0 to infinity in the other direction. And we used standardization to come up with a value between minus 1 and 1. So how do you know, can you remember how we come from the covariance to the correlation?
Divided by standard deviation.
Yeah, standard deviation of x1 and standard deviation of x2, the product, eh? Yeah, so dividing by the standard deviation of x1, so that's the square root of this, and the standard deviation of x2, and that's also the square root of this. So actually in this case, this situation, we divide this by the variance. So that would be equal to a half. I think very logical, isn't it? Correlation between the genotypes of two siblings, that is a half on an additive model. That's what we expect, since they share on average half of their genetic material. Okay, then back to linear regression. So we have seen these models that, so we skip the structure of individuals within families. We have just for the moment again one individual or single individuals in our data set. We have one covariate, and we have an intercept A, and B measures the effect of the covariate on the outcome Y. And then we discussed in the lecture that this error term should come from a normal distribution, and the variance should be constant over time. We should not, if we make a plot of Y fit versus the residual or the covariates versus residuals, it should all be smoothly distributed around the line. And if we see a kind of structure, then we know that the model didn't fit well, and we should think about how to improve our model. Okay, and I said that it was very important that these individuals in my data set were independent. But okay, so now we have this sibling pairs, and we observe, we skip for a moment still the sibling pairs. So let's assume now that we have this genotype that we defined in the previous slide. So this genotype for A, 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 B, and B, B, and that G, I changed notation here. So X is just the covariate sex or age, and I use now G for my random variable. So G is now 0, 1, or 2. 0 BB, 1 for the heterozygous, and 2 for having two copies of the ALU. And so C measures the effect of the genotype on my outcome Y. And the error is again, should be normally distributed and nicely around the lines in the plots we can make. Now, if this GI is the only cause why these outcomes of sibling pairs are correlated. So there is no other cause giving that the outcomes of the sibling pairs are correlated. If this is the case, then fitting these models to sibling pair data, so we have now actually YIJ, IJ and IJ, but since G models all the correlation in the sibling pairs, take care of it, my error term will still be independently normally distributed. And if you make a plot of this error term versus all the lines, that will be fine. So correcting, taking G in your model, in this case as a fixed effect, I will talk about mixed models, that's actually also random effect models, but these are fixed effects, so this fixed effect represents the cause of correlation by my siblings. I can model as a fixed effect, and my error term is a random effect, random residual effect, that is still independently distributed. So that's okay. But then, let's now assume that we didn't observe G. We don't have the genotypes. It's expensive to genotype this. We know it has an effect. And we have sibling pairs in our data, so we cannot correct for it. We're actually also not so interested in this genotype. We're interested in the effect of the relationship between this XI and this YI. But we know that the outcomes of the sibling pairs are correlated. So if we fit these pairs, this model, to our sibling pairs, then we have a problem because this correlation, this randomness due to the gene, this genotype has an effect, we didn't observe it, so it's an unobserved factor. Unobserved factors goes into this error term. So this genetic effect is now in this error term. And since we saw the correlation between these genetic effects is a half, so this error will not have correlation half because there are also older factors playing a role, but it will not have correlation zero. So we have a problem here. We cannot use this model anymore. But fortunately, we have mixed models. So what we do now, again, we have this sibling J of pair I or family I. We have caveats for the siblings, like sex, age, smoking status, treatment, whatever you want. We know there is a genotype having an effect on this Y, but we didn't observe it. So what we do, we plug in here another random effect, a UI. So in the first models, we didn't have this UI, it looks like this. We only have the random error term, but now we plug in a random U term. And since these two siblings have the same index, they also will have the same UI. And siblings of persons from different families will have different UIs. But we didn't measure it, so we cannot plug this genotype in the model, then we would have a fixed effect. But we know that these outcomes within sibling pairs will be correlated, and we see that also in the data. I will show you a figure later on. You can see that in your data. So, but we did not observe the cause. If you have such a situation, you can plug in a random effect UI in your model. And you assume that this UI is also follows also a normal distribution with mean zero and variance tau square, I typically use, and the error terms. So now the UI represents unknown effects shared by the family members in I. So in addition to genes, it can also be shared environments, it can be all genes, everything which we did not observe but is shared by the twins and has an effect on my outcome, that is represented by the UI. And the error term still represents the remaining unobserved factors. So this is the part we did not explain but gives correlation in DYs. And this is the part of Y which we did not explain but is not shared by the sibling pairs. So if we would have an independent model, I don't know what I have said here. Oh yeah, if we have these genotypes, let's go back one more. So if we have this model, but we don't have sibling pairs and we also have no genotype, then this genotype is just an unobserved vector and goes in the error term. Yeah, so if we have the same y's and the same x's, but we now have only one person per family, then we cannot estimate this ui because we have no information about the clustering. And it's just an independent vector, it's not shared, it's not correlated over the independent individuals. And this, then it's just modeled by this error term. So let's consider an example. Take BMI and say that we have family data, sibling pair data. Then we know that BMI is influenced by genetics. There are many, if you look up the literature there and the GWASs, there are many GWASs done for BMI. So there are many loci identified, small effects, larger effects. So it's clear genetics plays a role for in BMI. But we also know BMI is influenced by lifestyle, by by your daily activity, by the food you take. And this is also often running in the families. If you come from a family which always run the marathons, then probably you're also going to run the marathons. If you are from a family which has a very vegetarian family, you probably also be vegetarian and you have don't have this bad food which is bad, which gives you a gain in BMI. The nice thing is, we can have the situation that nothing is observed, none of the genes are observed, but it can also be that a part of the genetic markers are observed. And then still there is a missing part. So you can have genetics in this model, and make it a little bit more complex. So you can have in this model some of the genetics which explain the correlation in the sibling pair that can go in this X. And these genetic effects will then be fixed effects. But since you do not measure the whole thing, you won't measure the whole genome, the residual still has to go in this UI. And the same with lifestyle factors. Actually, we don't really know how that works. And also in the model, how do you measure food intake? There are questionnaires and these represent food intake, but they will not explain the whole thing. They will not tell you the truth about food intake. And we also don't know the relationship, what variables are important and not. So it's not so clear how to adjust for a lifestyle in a regression. But you might have something like going to the sports school several times a week or not. And that can be in as fixed effect, and all the remaining unobserved things are then still in the random part. Okay, is that clear? The random part represents things we did not observe, but we know they are there. We only observe them indirectly because we see that outcomes within families are correlated, or within classes, or whatever. Okay, so that is then the model, and we can also compute then the covariance between the outcomes of two sibling pairs. So again, we have the variance of ui tau square, the variance of the error term sigma square. This is the residual of outcome of sibling one. It's not the residual. This is the outcome minus the fixed effect part for person one. This is the outcome minus the fixed effect part for person two. And we can compute the covariance of that because that will be ui plus the error term and ui plus the error term for person two. Now that is the variance of this u, because we get u times u. Then the error term and the u, these two are uncorrelated. So we come up with a variance of u, the covariance of the error terms. But this is also zero, because these error terms were the unobserved, uncorrelated random factors. So this is zero. So we have that the covariance of these two terms is tau square. And so we see the larger tau square, the larger the variance, the more the outcomes will be correlated. And that with respect to the total variance of y. And the total variance of y will be tau square. I should have put that here. The total variance of y. Any random idea what would be the total variance of y minus a plus b x? If we take out the fixed effect part, what would be then the variance? What would be the variance if we take out of just of an outcome variable y when we adjust for the fixed effect part? So we have done the variance, if we write it down, it's the variance of ui plus the error. What would be this? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So if tau square is large relatively to this total, then we have a large cluster effect. And there are many factors which give clustering within sibling pairs. Yeah, this is the figure I promised. So here on the x-axis, I have 10 different sip-sips. And I made large sip-sips to make this plot interpretable. So I have this. I have sip-sips with of size 10, so 10 siblings per sip-sips. So these green, and on the y-axis the outcome variable, so this is the y. So here I have sip-sip 1 and there are 10 of them, and they are distributed here like them, so this is, they are have values of minus 1.4 to minus 2.2 in this sip-sip. If we take this one, they have values between minus 0.7 to, what is it, 0.04, I think. Yeah, is it clear what the green dots mean? So the green dots are the outcomes, and I ordered them to put with the sip-sips. So these are the values of sip-sip 1, sip-sip 2, sip-sip 3. Now then I can compute actually the mean per sip-sip. And then so actually, what do you think, what is this? This is the variation within the sip-sip. Would that be the error term or the u-term? U? So who's for u and who's for the error term? Who thinks it's the u, which gives the within variance? You think it's the u and you think it's the u? And who thinks the error term? That's two. Versus 2, or 3, you will say also the error, 3 versus 2, and the rest is uncertain. Yeah, this is always hard, but actually it's the within, because this is the variation due to other factors, because they share this u, they all have the same u. So within is due to all other things. Well, the variation over between these sip-sips, that is the variation of the u. And that's also, you had this question correct. You said that the variation, if tau square is large, we have a large effect. But we have a large effect if these sip-sips are very far from each other. So here we have a relative large effect. It's quite a difference between this sip-sip and this sip-sip and this sip-sip. But if they were all more close together, this was very close together, then we wouldn't have such a large sibling effect. If they were very close together, then the spread of this u would be smaller and tau square would be smaller. So this difference, this variation between these these zip chips, that is the cluster effect, and the within is the residual effect. I can remember still my first year as a PhD student that I didn't understand this, and that because it's counterintuitive, I think. But as soon as you understand it, you think it's the most normal thing of the world. Okay, so I just had here sibling pairs, but of course many examples, and I put here on the slide some of the examples. So students in the same class, they share the teacher. Elderly living in the same house, they share the same food. Families, gene and environment. Patients in the same hospital, they have the same doctors. Sometimes the effects of the region where they come from. Longitudinal effects, the outcomes measured over time are coming from the same patient, so they share the same patient. Results from various studies, meta-analysis, so this is a complicated one, but you can also see that in the random and mixed effect models. Are there any other examples? Did you come up with, do you have an other example for me? It's what Gordon talked about in his first lecture. You remember? One of the glycans.
Population
can be, yeah. I was not thinking about them, but that's a good one, yeah. Yeah. But yes, he said, I learned a lot from mnemonics. And then because he had his observations in plates. Yeah, a batch effect can also be a random effect. Yeah, because observation within the batch share the moment that they are in the machine. So there are many examples. But in this, for people who do the, students who do the experimental design project, they will see the correlation due to batch effects. And which is being measured at the same plate. Okay, so then we have one more part of the longitudinal data. This is also a random effects model, a mixed effect model, but it's a little bit more complicated. So we have now I as a person, and J is the index for the time point. And we have if we have a person and we have a sufficient, do I have the picture on the next slide? Yeah, I made here a picture of three persons of a data set. Actually, you should put here x and negative values, but it should change this. But assume that we have here time, so time zero and it goes on. And we have a person with blue values, and we have a person with pink values, and a person I denoted with the green values. Now we have different persons, so there can be mixed effects. But now we had before y is alpha plus beta x plus u plus error. Actually, what is u does is taking care that the intercept is random. For each person, for each family, I can sample from this random distribution. I get an effect, and so alpha plus this effect is the intercept. And if I have then another person, I sample another u, and alpha plus the u will be different, and it's an other effect. So we talk about random intercepts. So this person, if here's zero, but we can also say time zero, it doesn't really matter. We have here an intercept, but this person has another intercept, and this person has another intercept. And we say that these intercepts come from a normal distribution. And then we can make it even more complex, because we can also say that each person has his own line. And we see that here that these two have almost the same parallel lines, but this person is a little bit different. So we can also say that not only the intercept is random, which is a plus u, but also the beta is random. No. So I simulated this data set, therefore I had this I should have added started with time zero, but I didn't do that. But you can fit all those, and this data set I also analyzed, so these are three from the total individuals. I have total 7 groups. And to fit these mixed models, all mixed models, longitudinal or sibling pairs or family data, you can use LME4. It's a package in R, you can download it, and one of the function in LME4 is LMER. And so you have to tell now, so we have seen before that Y and X, that is the fixed effect part. That is how we did multiple regression and linear regression. We now need to add a random effect, and we should tell the program which is the variable which gives the grouping on, which tells me which is the group. Here I had individuals, so here I have made a variable which says that these 10 outcomes are from the same variable. So we'll make a structure of the data is often like this. If we have longitudinal data, we have individual, for example, and then we have 4, now we go to the second individual, and then we have time, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, and it doesn't have to be the exact same time, but we do it for this moment. But this tells the computer that these observations, then we have the outcome, that these outcomes come from this individual, and that these outcomes from for this individual. So to have a random intercept, we need the grouping variable int, and the random intercept means only a 1. Now, if you run this using this LME4 package, you get here the estimates we have seen before. This is the fixed effect part, so it's also called fixed effect. So the effect of X on the outcome, if X changes with 1 unit, Y changes with around 2. And here are now the variance components. So the residual variance is 1.2. And the cluster variance, just the variance of the U. Oh, I put it here now, just beta X plus error. So this variance is equal to 1.2, and this variance is, I made it very large here, is equal to 9.5. It can be that you are interested in these variances, it can be that you are not interested in these variances, you only are interested in the fixed effects. So there are, if you are only interested in the relationship between glycans and age, you are not interested in plate effects, but you have to take it into account, so you have to do something here, but you are interested in this part. Sometimes you are also interested in this part. For example, if you want to estimate the heritability. Okay, so, but now then we also want a random slope, so also this random. Now that is quite logical, then we put here X. So here we have X as fixed effect and here as X as random effect. And we see also we get here the estimates for the fixed effect part, it's almost the same. And we get now 3 random components, 1 residual component, 1 for the random slopes and 1 for the intercept. Okay, so this is, you have to try it out yourself and look in the output, but you can use this LME4 to run mixed models. And of course, there's also a nice help in R. So to finalize, when we have cluster data, we need mixed models to take care of the unobserved factors which correlate in the data. But mixed effects models are not so straightforward. If you just have the family of sibling pairs, you can just apply it, or a nice longitudinal study without missing data, so you can do it. But if you have complex random effect structures, it's good to talk with other persons about your model because it might not be identifiable. I tried yesterday something and it gives me results, but I saw it and thought it cannot be good. And I made a mistake in the model and my model was not identifiable. I have so much experience, so I see it immediately, but if you start using it, then you don't have this experience. And actually I was something fitting with 4 components instead of 3. So therefore you could also see it. If you have a random slope and a random intercept and a residual, you should have 3 variance components and not 4. And I did something wrong and got 4. But you might think, oh, it fits, it gives me an answer, I can also fit 4. But actually that was not true. There's no information what I did yesterday of 4 parameters. And when there is missing data, you also have to be careful with the interpretation of your model. So it's also good to discuss with others. Okay. Are there any questions about the mixed models?
When you fit the Kinship matrix into your model, is that a fixed effect or a random effect?
Then that's the article. Then you do not assume that this is 0 tau square. But you are going to assume that the correlation between uij and uik is the kinship. And that's a random effect, but with a complicated correlation structure, namely the kinship.